Hi, I'm Paul. In this video, we'll look together at the third movement of Beethoven's Sonata No. 8, best known as Sonata Pathétique. Tutorials for the first and second movements are linked in the video info. Although the third movement fully completes the sonata taken as a whole, a work that takes around 20 minutes to perform, it's a very enjoyable movement to practice as a standalone work. If you'd like to play this movement for yourself, I hope this video helps. Movement 3 is a rondo with many mood changes, and although Beethoven didn't give specific markings for changes in tempo, we tend to play it freely as if he did. To understand the spirit, mood and tempo changes and how they relate to each other from the beginning of the end of the piece, it's worth discovering or reminding ourselves about the form of the composition with a little music theory. A rondo is a piece of music with a distinct musical pattern. It has a principal theme, and this principal theme alternates with a number of contrasting episodes. Sometimes we call them couplets. The number of parts in a rondo can vary. Rondo Pathétique is a typical classical seven-part rondo. The seventh part transforms into a coda to end the work. We can write out the pattern of the parts of the rondo using letters. Part A is the rondo's principal theme. Parts B and C represent the episodes. The pattern of Rondo Pathétique is like this: A, B, A, C, A, B, A, with a coda. You'll notice there's intentional symmetry in respect to the theme alternating with episodes. Usually, rondos are allegro, but there are a number of slow classical rondos, such as Mozart's Rondo in A minor, K551. I'll play the opening. The seven parts of our rondo make seven ideal practice sections, so let's look together at each of these sections individually. The rondo opens with an exposition. An exposition is a musical term we use to describe the first time the composer presents to us the principal theme. In Rondo Pathétique, we hear, in the exposition, theme A for the first time. If we look at the form presented as musical letters, each time we see A, this means the main theme is played again. This is the main theme. Now I'll play the principal theme as written. Notice how the phrases rise and fall in differing degrees. We need to decide how we wish to play the principal theme and remember it, because we'll repeat it closely four times along the way. We do the same with the subject of Bach's fugues. We work out with preparation the character that best suits the subject, and all subjects are different. More often than not, the subject suggests itself with experience in terms of tempo, touch, legato, staccato, combination of both, and so on. Whatever we decide, this will be applied to all the subject entries throughout the fugue, even when mixed up with other voices and in a different register. In the rondo, we give the theme its character and stick with it in the repetitions. Here's the first 9 bars played in the way the character suggests itself to me in terms of touch, tempo and rise and fall. Although I want the melody to be heard, the left hand is very important and needs to be clear, very much in the classical playing style. As mentioned, although Beethoven didn't indicate any tempo changes in this movement, we can still play freely as if he had, and here's an example. When we leave section A, we pause in the transition, take a breath, and move into the first B episode. After a few flourishes up and down, we arrive settled in the middle of the piano playing quietly. We enjoy a few relaxed lyrical moments, and the music seems to suggest we play a little slower than previously. The mood suddenly changes and the music quickens with it, like this. A few of the many joys of playing this rondo is the way we get to pause in the episodes, catch our breath, then suddenly take off again in a gust of energy. Especially fun when the right and the left hand voices pass back and forth and sing with each other. Isn't it amazing how Beethoven takes a simple scale we play for finger exercise and transforms it into something intensely exciting, dark and dramatic? You might find there's something reassuring about the way the theme returns after the episodes throughout the rondo. A bit like going away from and coming back home. With a fast and furious fortissimo C harmonic minor scale, the rondo comes crashing headfirst from the top to the ground. We pick ourselves up and gently ease back into the lyrical mood of principal theme A. In 1798, the 27-year-old Beethoven was finding his voice as a composer. He seemed to find minor tonalities suited his temperament and developing musical ideas. Perhaps the Pathétique is a creation born of a reaction against the lighter piano music popular in the day, more often than not written in major keys. Rondos at that time were mainly cheerful and light-hearted. If Beethoven had Being a different type of composer, his rondo might have sounded like this. What a difference a minor key can make to the musical expression. In episode C, the right and left hands gently swing the legato melody back and forth expressively between the hands. The material sounds familiar as it's developed. After we've caught our breath, something completely new happens. We can't say unexpectedly, as we expect Beethoven to do the unexpected. The contrast of opposites gives us a long A-flat major scale played with a light staccato touch, and this carries us happily along out of the gentle A-flat major mood, almost imperceptibly, back to the C minor. The transition grows gradually out of nothing more than a sinister bass rumble, and after a long and dramatic crescendo, the mood changes into something dark and dramatic. We plunge from top to bottom, take a breath, in readiness for the return of the theme. A return to the rondo theme A in the recapitulation. Notice how theme A in this repeat is transformed into episode B halfway through. As mentioned, the episodes in a rondo are in different keys to the theme, and in this episode B, it's fun to watch how ingeniously Beethoven transitions out of the dark key of C minor by climbing gradually higher to the top treble, and we melt into a lovely, gentle, ethereal, long, light-filled phrase in the bright key of C major, which in turn transitions briefly to G major, back to C, and just as we expect to move finally to the key of F major, we discover it's not going to happen at all, it's just a transition, and with great ingenuity and expressive invention, we find ourselves eased ever so gently, rather than by the usual resounding harmonic scalic crash, as in the previous episode ending spack, in C minor for a repeat of theme A. After the theme, the coda quickly becomes dark, impassioned, building the tension unbearably in the extreme, but not as we might expect. The mood eases back to the comforting key of A flat major, We take a breath. Appreciate the calm, but Beethoven is playing with our expectations. He's building to the moment he'll unleash his masterpiece of contrasting opposites, and we find ourselves trapped in silent anticipation. The silence takes on a sinister atmosphere. Suddenly, without warning, the mood is smashed in the most dramatic way possible on a piano. We feel the full force of the effect of contrasting opposites. Now, I'll play through the whole of the third movement. I hope you found this video useful. Good luck with your practice and thanks for watching. Thank you.
Thank you.